Today, we're doing something a bit different, something, well, almost purely searchable. We're going to perform a very precise step-by-step calculation. Our mission is to derive the aggregate consumption function for a very specific two-part economy.
That's a great way to put it. This deep dive is all about the technical mechanics. We're not talking about policy implications or making predictions. The whole point is to walk you through the structure of the calculation to see exactly how individual behaviors combine to define a whole economy.
And the setup is pretty clear. We've got two different types of households. We'll call them type A and type B. They have different characteristics, and there's a really important rule governing how income is split between them.
Exactly. And our task is to take all those little pieces, the number of households, their individual spending habits, and that income distribution, and build it into one single equation for the entire economy.
Okay, so let's unpack this. We have to start with the individual groups, right? We need to understand them before we can combine them.
Let's start with type A. The problem states we have 25 of these households.
25, okay. And their individual consumption function is C sub A equals 20 plus 0.65 YD.
Right, so let's break that down. That 20 is their autonomous consumption. It's their baseline spending, what they spend even with zero income.
And in the 0.65, that's their marginal propensity to consume, their MPC. So for every extra dollar they get, they spend 65 cents of it.
Exactly. They have a relatively high spending floor, but they're a bit more conservative with new income. They save 35 cents of every new dollar.
Okay, so that's type A. What about the other group, type B?
No, type B is much larger. There are 90 of them, almost four times as many households as type A.
And their function is different, too. It's C sum B equals 10 plus 0.8 YD.
Right, so you can see the contrast immediately. Their autonomous consumption, that baseline, is only 10, half of what type A spends.
So they're more cautious at the baseline, but their MPC is 0.8.
Much higher. They spend 80 cents of every new dollar they get. So they have a lower floor, but they're much more eager to spend any extra income that comes their way.
So you've got this small group of high baseline spenders, type A, and a big group of high marginal spenders, type B. Okay, so the first step in combining them must be to just scale them up, right?
Precisely. We need to see what each group's total contribution is, starting with their autonomous spending. Let's tackle the 25 type A households first.
Okay, so if each of the 25 households spends a baseline of 20, you just multiply them, 25 times 20.
Which gives us 500. So group A as a whole contributes 500 in autonomous consumption. That's their fixed baseline spending.
Got it. Now for the 90 households in type B.
Same process. We have 90 households and their individual baseline is 10.
90 times 10 is 900.
Right. So now we have the total autonomous spending for each group. And with that, we can find the first major component of our final answer.
You just add them together?
Just add them up. The 500 from type A and then 900 from type B.
So that's 1,400.
Exactly. The total autonomous consumption for this entire economy is 1,400. That part is locked in. It's the amount of spending that happens no matter what the total income is.
That makes sense. That part feels pretty straightforward, just scaling up the numbers. But now we get to the tricky part, the part where the income rule comes in. This is where it gets really interesting.
This is the crucial link. We can't just average their MPCs, you know, the 0.65 and the 0.8.
Yeah.
That wouldn't mean anything. We have to know who holds the income before we can figure out how it gets spent on the margin.
And the problem gives us a very clear rule for that. It says the total disposable income of all the type A households is four times larger than the total for all the type B households.
Think about what that means for a second. We have only 25 households in group A.
And 90 in group B.
And yet that small group commands four times the total income of the much larger group. This is a model with some serious income inequality built right into it.
Right, that's a huge concentration. So if type A's income is, say, four parts, and type B's is one part,
then the whole economy's income is made up of five equal parts.
Which means we can figure out the shares. Type A gets four of those five parts.
Which is 80%. So the 25 households in type A control a massive 80% of the total disposable income. Their income weight, W sub A, is 0.8.
And that leaves the 90 households in type B with the rest, just one-fifth, or 20%.
Mm-hmm.
W sub B is 0.2.
And that 80-20 split is the key. It's the mechanism that's going to let us combine those two very different MPCs into a single number for the whole economy.
Okay, so now we're combining the individual spending behavior with the person who actually has the income. It's a weighted average.
It's exactly a weighted average. Our final aggregate consumption function will be that 1,400 we already found, plus a new combined MPC multiplied by the total disposable income.
And to get that new MPC, we take Type A's MPC and multiply it by their income share and add that to Type B's MPC multiplied by their income share.
Let's do it piece by piece. First, the contribution from Type A.
Okay, so their MPC is 0.65, and we multiply that by their huge 80% income share.
Right. 0.65 times 0.8. That means 80% of any new dollar in the economy gets filtered through the spending habits of this group. And that comes out to 0.52.
So Type A contributes 0.52 to the final aggregate MPC. Now for Type B, they have a higher MPC, 0.8, they're more eager to spend, but they're constrained by that small income share.
A very small share. So we multiply their 0.8 MPC by their 0.2 income weight.
And then 0.8 times 0.2 is 0.16.
That's their contribution. So to get the final aggregate MPC, we just add those two pieces together.
The 0.52 from Type A plus the 0.16 from Type B, that gives us 0.68.
And there it is. 0.68 is the single marginal propensity to consume for the entire economy. It's the synthesis of those two groups, forced into a compromise by the income distribution.
I just want to pause on that for a second. The final number, 0.68, is so much closer to Type A's 0.65 than it is to Type B's 0.8.
It is.
Even though Type B is a much bigger group of people and they're individually more willing to spend.
That's the core insight here, isn't it? The sheer weight of the income concentration in Type A pulls the entire economy's behavior toward their own. Their 80% income share means they completely dominate the marginal response. The enthusiasm of the other 90 households is, well, it's heavily muted.
It's a powerful demonstration of how structure can dictate outcomes. It's not just about how people behave, but about who has the resources to act on that behavior.
Absolutely. The weight of income trumps the willingness to spend, at least in this model.
So we've done it. We've walked through all the steps. We can now state the single unified consumption function for this whole economy.
We have both definitive components ready.
The final result is C equals, well, the autonomous part, 1400 plus our new aggregate MPC, 0.68 times YDC, says 1400 plus 0.68 YD.
And the single equation perfectly captures everything we started with. The two groups, their different behaviors, and that rigid 4-to-1 income rule. It's all baked into those two final numbers, 1400 and 0.68.
So just to recap the journey for you listening, we started with two distinct groups. We scaled up their baseline spending to get the total autonomous consumption of 1400. Then we used that critical 4-to-1 income rule to find the 80-20 income shares. And finally, we used those shares as weights to combine the individual MPCs into our final aggregate MPC of 0.68.
And a final thought to leave you with is to really focus on that structure. The aggregate MPC we found, 0.68, is strictly trapped between the two individual MPCs of 0.65 and 0.8. But where it lands between them is determined entirely by the income shares. Because the smaller, more conservative Type A group holds 80% of the income, they effectively set the pace for the entire economy's response.
It makes you wonder, if that income distribution rule was different, say 50-50, the aggregate MPC would have landed right in the middle at 0.725. A completely different economic response just by changing who holds the wealth. It really shows you how much that underlying structure matters.